I've been tasked with an interesting job. They had heard that I had written a book. I'd written several, but that's the one that's available right now. And it's basically, it's Punk Diary, and it's a history of how did we get from 1970, which is kind of an arbitrary date, up to the end of that, which is 1982, and how did this music that we call alternative music or punk rock or what have you unfold? Because I was there, I participated in this from that beginning journey all the way up. And I wanted people to be able to experience it the same way I experienced it day by day by day, because to me, it makes perfect sense how it happened. But a lot of people have bought into the VH1 myth that the Sex Pistols somehow went in and made a record and, oh wow, punk rock was created. And there's a lot of absolute crap out there on the internet and in other books that is just stuff that's just made up. And it's gotten worse with the internet, because the internet perpetuates half-truths and half-baked notions, and Wikipedia is... The book was compiled and written from actual source materials, first-generation stuff. When I quote something from NME or Sounds or Melody Maker or Interview Magazine or New York Rocker, it's because I have that issue in my closet, and I actually looked at it and transcribed it. The notes off the records, I own the records. I own all that stuff. And so that debris has now been organized for you. So what I'm going to try to do this evening is to try to take you how it happened, how that progression happened. And let's just ask, what was the first punk rock record? Anybody have a notion? I mean, when I used to ask this ages ago when I was in my ill-begotten youth teaching a class in history of rock and roll over at Eastfield, we would ask, what was the first rock and roll record? Which was always got some very interesting results. But what was the first punk rock record? Does anybody have a notion of what they would put up as that first one? A lot of people say Sex Pistols, Anarchy in the UK. Fair enough. Some people will say it must have been something by the Ramones. Excellent guess. Some hip people might even say, no, surely the Damned or the Buzzcocks had their record out first. Good guesses as well. But let's just try to explode a few myths here. I put Iggy Pop on the front cover of this book for a reason. When you come down to it, Iggy is the guy who pretty much invented what we know as punk rock. Now, I have to say, my first encounter with punk rock was in, it would have been around late 75, early 76, about the time I got to North Texas State. I was straight out of high school. I was completely disaffected with rock and roll. I hated music by Queen and Journey and Kansas and the Eagles, just bored me to tears. I had started out my musical journey in the early 70s when I was in high school. I was an enormous big band fan. And then I went through listening to 50s music and learned all about doo-wop music, and then came up, and by the time I left high school, I was up to listening to garage bands of the 60s. I learned the music in the progression that it occurred historically. That's how my taste changed over about a four-year period. And I grew up in a house that I was never exposed to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones in my house, despite having a bunch of older brothers. So I really was coming at music kind of unformed and new, except what I had learned playing an instrument in high school, which is why I guess I started off with big band music, because that was a connect for me. When I got to college and was so disaffected with all popular music at the time, but I was connected to what was called, in record collector parlance, punk rock. And punk rock at that time was a small group of bands like The Music Machine, The Seeds, Question Mark and the Mysterians. They were those not quite psychedelic garage bands that were making records on their own. And we would see in the press, in the New York Rocker, most often in the New York Rocker, these articles talking about this new punk rock band or that new punk rock band or what have you. And there was a friend of mine and I at college, and we started talking about this, and we would see ads in the back for a particular record shop that specialized in punk rock records. And so we would started mail ordering some of these odd and aberrant records. Half the time, the stuff we got was utter crap. I mean, it was terrible. And other times it was absolutely wonderful. But in every occasion, it was something so wholly different from Journey, Styx, Led Zeppelin, Queen, that it got our attention. And a lot of times, it was really funny stuff. I mean, just like mind-bendingly funny stuff. So, let me play you a couple things. We'll start off with a few records that come before my experience, and then we'll catch up pretty quick. I arbitrarily started the book at 1970. I should have started it in 1969, but 70 is much better. My editor says it's a nice cleaner break to start a book at 1970 than 69. It's like, fine, okay. So we'll take you to 1969 from Iggy Pop's first album. And if you consider this record was made at the same time as, let's put it in context, Jimi Hendrix, Woodstock, the band, you know, all that sort of hooey of the 60s. And we get this. I promise I hit the go button. There we go. Not only the sound of the song, but even the subject matter is this could have come right out of 76. Here we have Iggy and the Stooges singing, "Now I Want to Be Your Dog." Not exactly a theme we've heard in music very many times in the 60s, but hey, it was, you know, it was a new thing. And Iggy and the Stooges, if you've ever seen any film of him in the early 70s or 69, he was something completely out of step with what was going on. And he didn't care. You know, that was the beautiful thing about Iggy. He continued with several albums about that. The Funhouse came in 1970, and then Raw Power came out in 1973. The Stooges kind of fell apart. He went off on his own. And he started having his influence in New York with a band called the New York Dolls. And the New York Dolls were in some ways kind of like the Rolling Stones, except they were trying to be a little more outrageous, and they didn't mind going on stage in total transvestite outfits, just to upset people. This would be July of 73. So here we have the New York Dolls, and they're bringing something else to the party. They are kind of doing what the Stones were doing, but they're bringing a homosexual subtext to it as well. Now, this is going to play out in a lot of the punk rock stuff. There's this myth out there that the whole punk rock thing is a purely political beast, that it was rebellion against the man and against government and what have you, and that's utter crap. The percentage of bands that were actually into political stuff and used it as a tool down that road is probably less than 10%. In fact, I had this discussion. I worked for 5 years one-on-one with Johnny Rotten of the Sex Pistols. And we did first a radio show, and then we did a national television show with VH1. And Johnny elected to work with me because he liked the honesty of my book, that I told the story correctly and he knew that I understood him. And I also wouldn't take any of his crap. And we used to have these talks, and he said, at one time we were at a meal, and he said, "Well, you know, I really like doing the show with you because you understand you were there." And I said, "Well, yeah, and you've got this myth around you, and I'm just gonna guess, I bet I know the four reasons why you started the Sex Pistols." He said, "Okay, Mr. Smarty Pants, give me the four reasons, the four big reasons." I said, "Okay, number one, it was something to do so you wouldn't have to work." Absolutely right. "You might pick up a girl." Absolutely right. "Free beer." Reason number three. "And it's fun to upset people." The four reasons of the Sex Pistols. Not uncommon with the same reasons that were maybe used by Elvis Presley. and Bill Haley and Artie Shaw and Hank Williams. And these are constants in music. People who are like me do not really want to have a real job, sometimes pursue things that seem fun that we can make a living at. In music, it's no different. There are many people out there who have pursued these four virtues, but might not be honest enough to say it. With Johnny and a lot of the punk rockers, they were clearly there, but the press like to see, look for grander and more nobler things that they can put their criticism into, so hence the myth of punk rock being a political vehicle was born out. And some of the bands actually rose to it and wrote some political things. The Clash are a great example. The Clash, when we get to them, wrote several songs that had political they had one of their albums, they called it Sandinista. Sandinista. And Joe Strummer actually admitted to me in an interview that I could have called it anything I liked the sound of the word. Well, what does Sandinista mean? He says, well, I kind of think I know what it means, but it could mean I've got my hair on backwards. You know, it was a nice word, and he had heard it in the news, and it had some kind of rebellious image in Central America, so let's go with that. Well, people look at the album and they go, oh, wow, we should support the Sandinistas because Joe Strummer. Oh, God. You know, it would drive you crazy if you actually tried to follow all the little paths. He would go on stage. And in fact, there's a great scene in Rude Boy, the movie that he made in 1980, where he's in a Brigati Rossi t-shirt, which was a communist Italian terrorist group, and he's got their t-shirt on, and somebody asks him about it in the movie. And in the movie, he admits, it's a great-looking shirt. You know, well, you wear a shirt like that, you'll influence people. Well, he didn't care. It was fashion. Similarly, in later days, you saw some of the punks who would actually they would wear swastikas. And it's not that they were Nazis. There was a National Front group in England at the time that was rather active that were real Nazis. And the punks would do concerts against these people because they didn't like them. But at the same time, they would sometimes wear swastikas. Why? Because it would upset people. And it got them attention. And it maybe got them girls. It's rock and roll. So just don't take it serious. Let's move up. We're going to come up to 1974. This is another record that is just prior to my experience, although I did purchase this record about the time that I got to North Texas, because a friend of mine assured me that it would be the weirdest thing I had ever heard. Here we go. This defined the outer edge of music in 1974. This is a group called The Residents. This was the first time I had ever heard a record that was actually made by somebody themselves that had no connection to a company, a label. It was total do-it-yourself time, and they were mysterious, they were bizarre, and they didn't care. They made 1,000 copies of this album and sold it to their friends. Weird stuff.
Breath and length and breath and width and width and width.
Very, very strange stuff. On the other hand, this was going on at the same time. This is what average AOR listening to people would have heard in 1974 is a band like this that sounds like they've listened to every Eagles record and memorized it. This is a band called Milkwood. They're from Boston. A failed band. They didn't ever really get anywhere as Milkwood or as Captain Rabbit, which I think was the name that they used after this. And then they started seeing, in 1976, they started seeing the changing fortunes in music and would reinvent themselves, updating their attire, shortening their names, and adopting a new wave sound, and they became The Cars. Massively successful, but this is where they were in 1974 when I was kind of like annoyed with stuff like this, but I have the record for some reason.
And I still feel alone.
January of 1974 also has the first rehearsal of the Ramones. This is a pivotal moment. This is one of those seminal moments that you know, if you could go back into a time machine, where would you go? The JFK assassination, you watch Da Vinci finish up this. No, I would be at the first rehearsal of the Ramones. The Ramones, a massively influential band who never really got their fair due in filthy lucre. Everybody would become influenced by them. The Ramones, let me see if I can actually let them explain to you what they're doing here. I think I've got it. Let me just. I will get to it. The Ramones come out at a time when music is just, it's big and boring and bloated, and they couldn't do it. So they said, well, why don't we just do short songs and do it ourselves? And they put together this band. It took them a while. It took them about a year before they put Joey on lead vocals, by the way. And they decided to all adopt the name Ramone and all dress alike. And they started trying to get gigs in the lower side of Manhattan, which was tough. Although they did find a place called CBGB's down in the Bowery. It was a toilet of a club, but they started playing there. So you've got the New York Dolls, and now you've got the Ramones added to the thing. Patti Smith, a beat poet, is also starting to knock around. There's a group called Bonsai and the Beach Blondes, which becomes Blondie. They're knocking around in 74, 75. And so the scene is starting to brew in New York. And there's another little band called the Neon Boys. The Neon Boys has two guys who would become important. We have a guy named Richard Hell, and we have Tom Verlaine. Now, Tom Verlaine would go off and start a group called Television. Richard Hell would start Richard Hell and the Voidoids. And ultimately, okay, see if we can follow this. When Richard Hell goes off and does the Voidoids, it's 1976. It's late 75, 76. The New York Dolls, who we talked about earlier, are falling apart due to the death of their drummer and drugs. Just entirely too many drugs. And they're falling apart, so much so that they've lost their manager. They get this new manager who comes in from Britain, who really likes the band and wants to kind of resurrect their career. The guy's name is Malcolm McLaren. So Malcolm McLaren comes to New York, and he starts trying to work with the New York Dolls, but they're falling apart at the seams. And he's looking around for something else to do, and he discovers this guy, Richard Hell. And Richard Hell is kind of doing something different beyond what the Dolls were. And he's also wearing t-shirts that are intentionally cut up and held together with safety pins. Malcolm's a bit of a fashion hound. He loves the look. So he steals that look and runs it back to England. Doesn't take Richard with him, he just takes the look. So early 76, he's taken what will become punk fashion back to England. That's the first time this ethic crosses the Atlantic. So we're in the US, 1974, 75, right around in there, and here's another piece of really aberrant music. This is a rare recording you might never have known existed. I didn't even know this existed until a couple years ago. This is bizarre. Here again, taken in the context of 1974, what was going on? This was very strange.
Papa's big punch.
There's a bunch of college kids who called themselves Diva. Now, they wouldn't make a record for another 4 years, but they're already knocking around in little studios doing stuff like this.
Yosemite Sam.
And let's see if I've got it set up right. This is what they had to say when I talked to Devo many times over the years. I asked him about the whole aesthetic of, you know, how they had the, and I hopefully you've seen pictures of Devo, where they would come out in the chemical suits and the 3D glasses, and they were truly odd looking.
We're just merely musical reporters. We just observe what's going on around us, take in information, and spit it back out for people to analyze from a different direction.
Why all the industrial stuff? Why the aesthetic of plastic and rubberware?
It's what we grew up with in Ohio.
We came from the rubber capital of the world, and the rubber factories are the center of Akron, Ohio. It's the heart of Akron, Ohio is the rubber factories, and that's where we grew up.
So there's as many stores that sell industrial products as there are that in California that would sell shorts and sandals.
Is it a dismal town? Do you resent that bringing up?
Well, it's just real Midwest industrial. It's no culture. It's a wasteland. People grow up to be big babies. They, you know, drive their vans and take too many Quaaludes and get married and beat their wives.
Real suspicious of new ideas.
You probably woke up a lot of people when you started breaking out.
Yeah, and they don't like it when you wake them up like that.
Right, we were kind of a lightning rod for negative energy while we were in Akron, and they were and still are just as glad that we're gone as we are.
So, there you go. And they've stuck with it. I mean, through all the years, these guys are true to form because they are the real deal. Okay, we've kind of explored what was happening on in the rock world, the beginnings of the punk thing, and we've got the real bizarre stuff that's going on in Akron. There's a number of bizarre bands that are happening up in Akron. There's another group called Perubu that's also knocking around town in 73, 74. Chrissy Hine, who's from Akron, would suck up a lot of this stuff, want to become a rock journalist, go to England, and would eventually start a group called The Pretenders. Now, she's also well-known among me and probably nobody else because she is the person, Chrissy Hine of The Pretenders, remember this, is the person who gave Sid Vicious the chain and lock, which was his signature thing that everybody, oh, Sid Vicious. In fact, there's little Sydneys out there all over the world who think the Sex Pistols, you know, still exist somewhere in some magical land and want to recreate it, and they all wear the lock, the dog collar and little lock. We can blame that on Chrissy Hine. Here is another facet of what was going on. One that I have not explored before is electronic music. Now, electronic music used to be the purview of college-educated folks that were way into computers. In the days before Moog synthesizers in the 50s, Columbia University would have a lab where they would, you know, do these instruments that had great cables and fiddle with tape loops and what have you and create some really unusual stuff, but it wasn't really what you'd call musical. 1967, when the Moog synthesizer becomes affordable, you know, it's still thousands of dollars, but it becomes affordable, it sweeps through the industry and a lot of bands start buying a Moog. Most of them because it afforded them a way to replace band members inexpensively. But there were some people who actually looked at the Moog as a true instrument. One of the first big hit records, and many of you probably had this in your household, was the Switched on Bach album that you took classical music and did it on a Moog. And, you know, Walter Carlos also became a very big deal with this sort of stuff. But in Germany, where they really like a lot of the industrial stuff, in 1970, there was a band called Kraftwerk. And Kraftwerk were everything a German band should be. Dead serious, dark-haired, uniformed, and completely humorless. They made some really interesting stuff. This is their first, the hit that they actually stumbled into, which was astounding that they actually had a hit, was this bit of electronic music, and it was called Autobahn. Classics with a synthesizer, they're creating new music with a synth and actually doing it melodically. That was kind of a new thing. Kraftwerk started out very mechanical. They quickly went to doing melodic stuff like this in 74, which would soon be followed by a hit record, the theme song from Tubular Bells, which was Mike Oldfield, which was also done with synthesizers. That followed this, and all of a sudden, a synthesizer is looked at not as a cute instrument or something silly, but it's actually something that can create new sounds. And a ton of other bands would follow Kraftwerk's example. We're just setting the pieces in place here because the whole underground music scene, you know, everything kind of like starts out like this and then narrows and then will blossom. So that piece is in place. We also have Bob Marley and the Wailers, massively influential because we have you've got the West Indian culture that exists in England, and Bob Marley starts having huge hits and a huge impact in England, okay? How does reggae fit into punk stuff? Well, it's strange to think, but a lot of the people that were involved in the early punk days were so disaffected with music, they were gonna look for something else to listen to anywhere they could, and they gravitated towards reggae. It was very odd when I found that out, because when I was in college in 75 or 76, I was doing the same thing. I was listening to reggae music. And I didn't really know why, except it was interesting and I'd never heard anything like it. I didn't know my counterparts across the Atlantic were doing the same thing, and people in New York were doing the same thing, and people in LA were doing the same thing. So it became another little ingredient that was put into the stew that would create this, you know, alternative music. Okay, as we're moving up, 1975 sees the birth of the Sex Pistols as a unit. Malcolm McLaren, the designer, the clothing designer, starts auditioning. He wants to create a band kind of like the New York Dolls, and he auditions people. There's already a little band kind of knocking around, and he takes them under the wing and says, you need a new lead singer, you need to have clothing. I'm gonna have your clothing designed by Vivian Westwood. She's really cool. She's got this thing she's come up with slits and safety pins. And so they start dressing the band and trying to get them booked. And the band at this point is raw, abrasive, abusive, nasty, and fantastic. They create this huge stir. But they have not yet made a record. They have not yet played a single date. They have only been seen in rehearsals by a few of his friends, because they don't quite know, is it ready for exposure yet? Is it quite time to bring this stuff out? Because we are really out here and we're really cool and nobody's gonna really like this beyond just us and our little tiny circle of friends. About the same time, the Ramones put out their first album, spring of 1976. And it's an earthquake. This album gets critically reviewed as being the freshest thing you've ever heard. Radio stations refuse to play it because it's just the stupidest album they have ever heard. I recall vividly when it was handed to me at the radio station up at North Texas, and I spun up Beat on the Brat with a baseball bat, oh yeah. And I just about fell over laughing. This was the funniest record I had ever heard. It sounded like the Beach Boys on amphetamines. And I thought, I've got to find out who these guys are. Well, they're from New York. And they've been playing there for a while, and they've been signed by a major label, which was a mind blower right there. And it wasn't long after that that they started getting picked up by a few adventurous souls who would find them in record stores and start meeting each other over the record bins. That's generally how words spread. It was not being played on the radio at all. Then the Ramones did something absolutely astounding. They were picked up by their record company, Sire Records, picked them up in the UK for some reason. And they decided to go to the UK about the same time as that record was being released. The date, an easy one to remember, 4th of July, 1976, our bicentennial. And the Ramones are playing the Roundhouse in London, which is a pretty fair-sized gig. It's about 1,200 people. This was one of those gigs that the Ramones thought, why are we playing a gig this large? We should be playing at a club. We're used to playing CBGBs, 125 people at the tops, but they've got us into this large place. They needn't have worried. The word about the Ramones had spread through the underground in London, and the place was packed. If you had enumerated all the different people that were there in the audience at that time, you would probably find every third person started their own band after that concert. This was the Johnny Appleseed moment. It was the revenge of the American Revolution, whatever you want to call it. 4th of July on the bicentennial 1976, and the Ramones land in England, and the ripples would happen for the next 20 years. It was a phenomenal thing. They're about the same time, they have emboldened other people to see that this might be a commercially viable enterprise. So the Sex Pistols actually start playing gigs. Because the Sex Pistols start playing gigs and playing as often and frequently as they can without getting run out, other bands start springing up and it becomes like a musical fungus. Everybody who is disaffected with Queen and all that other pompous crap that was on the radio start saying, I want to make music and do it myself. Well, does it matter if you can play? No, not really. Does it matter if anybody cares to come listen to you? Ooh, no, we don't care. We just want to annoy people, drink beer, pull a few birds, you know, the usual rock and roll reasons. So the scene starts bubbling in England. It's already been bubbling in New York, but we gotta say, this is another myth exploder. The scene begins in New York. It doesn't begin in England, it begins in New York. But they are two totally different beasts at this point. The New York scene is very rock and roll based. The British scene is a lot of things. It does have some electronic stuff. It does have some reggae-based stuff. It's a lot of different flavors, more so than the New York, and will eventually envelop the New York scene and begin influencing it, which is probably why, you know, all these years later, people forget that this actually started in New York. Or if you talk to somebody from Ohio, they'll say it started in Ohio or LA or whatever their hometown is. Let me play you another couple of odd things. This is a great example of showing the odd influence. This is a band called the 101ers, May of 1976. Here we go. Down at the pub in England, and it's called the 101ers. A fairly straight ahead little pop song. The lead singer of this group, it was funny. There were two separate occasions where this band, the 101ers, were the headliners, and there was an opening band called the Sex Pistols that nobody really heard of. The band, the 101ers, would never actually, this lead singer anyway, would never actually show up early enough to see the opening act. And then one day, he did. He actually came and saw the band, and he was just like, oh my God, I'm playing the wrong stuff. And he quit the 101ers. He quit the 101ers a week after that record was recorded and released. He just kind of chucked it all and went off, found some other friends, and they started a new band, and they called it The Clash. That's Joe Strummer on the verge of having his life-changing epiphany. What's funny is, in the years that passed, Joe crept back to those roots, and his last music almost began to sound back where he started. But sometimes these things happen. Let's try another one. This is from one of the first independent labels that started up in England, and an independent label was a pretty big deal, because at the time, the recording industry had a stranglehold on what was not only on the radio, but what was in the record shops. There were a handful of large labels, very much like it is kind of today in the actual record world, and they pretty much controlled everything. Well, there was this guy named Jake Riviera, and he said, well, to hell with that. I've got a little bit of money. Let me see if I can get some records pressed up. And he started a label called Stiff Records. And they had all sorts of cute sayings that I really can't repeat here, but the upshot was they started just recording some local acts and spewing out 1,000 copies of these records and finding out that these things sold. And they kept going and going and going. They became the first independent label in England that actually started participating in this new punk rock revolution. And by the time of their 12th, 13th, 14th release, they found that they were selling around, you know, between 25 and 50,000 records on each of their little homemade releases. That's a lot of records for a label that's getting absolutely zero radio play, and they're not in the big, you know, mega store shops. They're just being sold through little mom and pop stores that are now beginning to appear, who specialize in this rather aberrant music. Now, they don't have much to sell, but what they do get in bangs right out the door.
Is she really going out?
And this is one of their earliest efforts.
I've got a new rose, I've got a good. Yes, I
That's a group called The Damned and their song New Rose. Now, the strange part is, of course, you listen to this thing now with all the hindsight of the years, that sounds incredibly tame. I mean, that just doesn't, that sounds like kind of an average little garage metal-y sort of band from LA. That was a really out there record in 1976. And that's part of the reason why I wrote the book and compiled it, is so that you could see it in the context of what else was happening in pop culture at the time. The Damned become not only one of the earliest British punk bands to make a record, but they're also one that go totally overboard when it comes to costuming. Now, rock and roll bands prior to this hadn't really seen costuming in rock and roll since the 60s, where you remember Paul Revere and the Raiders all had their Revolutionary War outfits, or the Beatles had their matching suits or their Sgt. Pepper outfits or what have you. And then we all kind of got away from that in hippie days, and that's the way it was in the 70s. Well, the Damned, when they came out on stage, you would have Captain Sensible, and Captain Sensible would be frequently in either a nurse's uniform or in a tutu. Dave Vanian, the lead singer, well, he liked to dress up like Dracula for some reason, so he would come in full white makeup and a large cape. And we had a bass player who wore a fuzzy pink jumper that looked like somebody's old bathroom carpet that was about that thick, and it was pink, and he just kind of looked like a big fuzzy bear, but he was playing in this punk. It was a very strange sight, but nobody else was doing it. And the theatrics of it, and also the fact that these bands who could not get booked into ordinary clubs started finding them, the only places who would take them in were the gay bars of London. Here again, we're back to that. So the early days of punk found a lot of their audience in these gay bars. And of course they became fans, and those fans wound up in bands themselves, and it just kind of all churned. So there became this very strange undercurrent that the straight people just saw as a little bit of flavor, but some people saw as a little bit of a musical revolution, all dependent on where you happen to fall on that. Here's an important record. Another one of those watershed moments. We find ourselves in November of 1976. This is just on the heels of New Rose from The Damned and from Richard Hell doing Blank Generation. Things are really heating up in this underground. And this remarkable record is released on EMI, which is strange because it was coming from a very, very major label. Put this little bit of vinyl. A remarkable record, Anarchy in the UK by the Sex Pistols. It was their debut on vinyl. Somehow Malcolm McLaren had managed to coax a major label in England to releasing this record. And everything was going pretty well until about a week after that record was released, the band was being sent out on a tour of England, and they had about 30 dates planned. Before they left for the trip, just 2 days before they left for the trip, there was a sudden cancellation on a tea time show called The Bill Grundy Show, which was just this kind of old geezer who would have on guests and in the middle of the afternoon would talk and entertain housewives. And I think it was Brian May from Queen who was supposed to be the musical guest on the show and couldn't make it for one reason or another. And somehow Malcolm got the band booked into doing the show. Now, the Sex Pistols were really not to be trusted in public. They were unschooled, they were rude, they have no sense of decorum, and they might say something to upset people, because after all, that was one of the four things that was very important to them. John tells me that they really didn't know that the show was on live. Maybe. There is no doubt the host really didn't give a whit about this band. Didn't care for them, didn't like them. He had been drinking quite a bit. And he does a little interview with them. And the band happens to utter a few naughty things that you shouldn't say on the BBC, especially at tea time, under their breath. He goads them into, "Ooh, what did you say? That sounded like a rude word." Well, this led the band to repeat these rude words at full volume so they could be understood, and the show kind of falls apart at that point, and the band leaves the studio. Malcolm is horrified. He thinks that people are going to come and find, you know, clubs and beat them to death. What ends up happening is Bill Grundy ends up being fired from the BBC. The Sex Pistols become the scourge of England, getting what turns out to be incredibly valuable press on all the national papers, front page of all the national papers. It's a huge scandal. Well, it costs them all but three of their dates on that tour. Everybody cancels. City councils come out and have the band banned from their city. They are not even allowed to come here. Just, you know, bar the gates of the city. This is bad news, but good news, because it sells records. And the records start selling astoundingly well. It goes to number one in England. However, you wouldn't know that because the charts that week have the position of number one left blank. They have all the way up to number two, Rod Stewart, "Do You Think I'm Sexy?" And number one, some other record. It wasn't reported, but everybody knew. It was God. It was anarchy in the UK. Because of all this hoopla, there are some complaints at EMI. There are little ladies who work in the packing department in the back who refuse to touch the record. So it's not getting sleeved and packed to go out to stores anymore. And Chairman Reed, who's part of the old, you know, it's the guys who used to be part of the Raj or whatever, who happen to be running the company, decide that the Sex Pistols have to go. Well, they've got a multi-album contract, so he has to pay them off to make them go away. So the band have a hit single and a lot of money in their pocket and a ton of press. They have to capitalize on it. They have to go and release another record while the timing is just right. There's a huge story connected to that, which I encourage you to watch a documentary called The Filth and the Fury, which is basically the story of the Sex Pistols, which gets into how they ended up getting to the next record company and the next record company. They wound up going through several labels and pocketing a lot of money because they were so outrageous. As a side story to this whole thing, a few years ago, when the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame inducted the Sex Pistols into that vaunted hall or mausoleum, if you will, Johnny Rotten and the Sex Pistols declined to attend, which was really sad for me because John and I had worked out what they were going to do when they picked up their award, and I'll share that with you. It was going to be, and it had a lot to do with the fact that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is all about preserving the past and putting it on a pedestal and holding it up, that it's this wonderful thing to be emulated, thus ensuring that music will be caught in this sludge of the past and not be able to move forward. So we have kids who, I was reading today about a band of high school students who play classic rock tunes, and it's like, well, that's terrible. They should be playing their own music. They should not be playing their grandparents' music. So the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame helps this, and John and I think it should just be dismantled. I mean, it's quaint to go and look at the original lyrics to A Day in the Life, but for crying out loud, you don't need to give people awards and to put them on pedestals and make them unapproachable. Well, this is what was happening to the Sex Pistols. And the other little side story was, at the very ceremony that the Sex Pistols were being awarded their Lifetime Achievement Award or whatever it was, they were also honoring another grand figure of rock and roll, and that is Herb Alpert. I've never quite worked out how Herb Alpert was this great hero of rock and roll, but he did have a connection with the Sex Pistols, and that was that when the Sex Pistols got that second record deal, it was for a song called God Save the Queen, which was pretty in your face, especially during the Queen's Jubilee, when London was all turned out to celebrate her years on the throne, and here they're singing a song, How the Queen is Making Us a Moron. Herb Alpert was goaded into firing the band from his label before the record was even released by two of his very big acts, The Carpenters and Peter Frampton, which was kind of unfortunate. So Herb Alpert and his Tijuana Brass get the Sex Pistols kicked off the label, yet they are going to be honored at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the same setting as the Sex Pistols. So it was we were going to have Johnny actually confront verbally that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame had totally missed the point of the Sex Pistols, which was about destroying the past and building a new tomorrow. And they chose to honor the very person who kept him from that mission and firing him before his greatest record, which is that record, which is why I'm here. You're honoring the person who kept that from happening. It seemed to have both sides of the same coin. It's a rock and roll moment that never happened. I wish it would have, but Johnny opted for the easy out, as he sometimes does. As we go through 1976 and 77, there are so many bands that were releasing incredible records, whether it was the Adverts or the Ramones or the Damned. And we had talked earlier about the Clash. Let me show you how they made their debut. It was kind of in your face too. Fashionable political lyrics. Based on there were a lot of race riots going on in London at that time, clashes with the police, and Joe Strummer and the guys were right in the middle of it. Their rehearsal space was where this was all happening, so they start singing White Riot, I want a riot, I want a riot of my own, which is kind of a strange message that you didn't hear in song very often. Very, very provocative. They also got signed by a major label, Columbia Records, CBS Records signed them in England. Which was a very strange thing, because what was an indie movement, what was started in small clubs, and everybody thought this is just us and our friends who know about this, all of a sudden some of the headline acts start getting picked up by major labels. And there was a lot of consternation about this. You know, are they selling out or not? Oh, well, it kind of, in some cases, made the bands act a little more outrageously just to prove themselves. Now, let's find another one of the strange facets that happened at this same time. And it was this band called The Jam. This is completely unexpected in 1976-77 that this should happen. So this band, in the midst of all this punk stuff, their seed of rebellion finds them kind of reinventing 1965 through a punk idiom. They dress in black suits, white shirts, skinny ties, as a lot of that crowd did at the time, but they're playing songs that wouldn't have been that far out of place with groups like The Who a decade earlier. And with the working class in England, this found a great home. They were picked up by Polydor Records, and they would become, over the next 3 or 4 years, one of the number one bands in England. Very commercial. They kept themselves apart from everybody else for the greatest time. They were the de facto, what was called, mod band at the time. And there were few people that could begin to touch that. And it was just another one of these little offshoots from the punk thing. Here again, picked up by a major label. Now, I have to say that the majority of the stuff I'm talking about, Sex Pistols, The Clash, whether it's The Stranglers or what have you, these things are major labels in England. They get released in America at the same time. Radio won't touch them. These acts are not finding any support via the media, except in the underground press and people who haunt these little record stores that would see each other across the aisles and would recommend, oh, you ought to check out, you know, such and such, such and such. So these records sold astoundingly small numbers of records. but they found place with people who would later trickle up influence throughout all manner of things. So things like the first Sex Pistols album, which would be released in 1978, or late 77 rather, didn't sell probably more than 10 or 15,000 copies in the US. That's a real big flop. But that record would lead to so many bands starting up in their own garages in the US. It was sowing the seeds of a revolution, musically speaking, to go against the status quo, which was the big bands that nobody could emulate. Because at the time, with garage bands, you would have, you've got you and your friends, and you've got your little band, and it used to be, and I mean, this goes back, you can go back to the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, you would listen to what's on the radio, I can do that, let's do our version of the Beatles, let's do our version of, you know, what Hank Williams is doing, let's do our version of, you know, whatever, and you kind of emulate that with your little group to your friends, and you play at the high school. When we get into the 70s, there's no garage band in the world that's going to listen to that record by Yes and even dream that they could do that. It was just, you couldn't even begin to, oh, yeah, I bet our little band of people who have just learned to play our instruments last week, we can do that David Bowie album. Sure, no problem. We can sound just like Genesis with 10 years of work. So these garage bands start springing up, and they are abandoning left and right what the status quo is. And it's all started by these little upstarts with records that hardly anybody's buying. And isn't that the way it always is with important movements? The beatnik movement of the 1940s. Jack Kerouac surely sold a few books in the 40s, but he was more famous in the 50s and 60s when he had already kind of retired from writing. It's kind of after the fact that people find that little thing. And this happens in art, you know, all the time. Let's find some other odd moments. Oh, I've got a lovely moment. Okay, let's see if I can find. We'll go to the Ramones again, because it is a deep well worth visiting. And this is kind of where they were in 1977. Well, the kids are all It's so funny to me, listening to this record now, this is such an incredibly tame record. And it was in 1977, so far out on the edge, and it was so very funny. It is a cartoon band. I mean, you can see this. The Ramones were a cartoon band. The Rolling Stones are a serious band. This is a cartoon band. There's a great sense of humor here. And rock and roll had pretty much lost its sense of humor by the late 70s. So this stuff appealed on so many different levels to some of us who were just looking for, you know, something, anything to take the edge off. This is a little piece. This has never been released. This is one of the recordings I managed to save from the trash can in my time at KZEW. This is the Ramones. The first time they played the Dallas-Fort Worth area, they played at Panther Hall out in Fort Worth. And this is, we're gonna catch you between two songs. Joey hardly ever spoke on stage, except you would hear 1, 2, 3, 4, and they would launch into the next song. They weren't exactly into stage patter. This is one of the few times I've ever heard him do some stage patter, and it conjures an image that you really need to have put into your head, okay? It will take you to the Ramones Panther Hall, February of 1978. Let's go!
Well, after eating at Pancho's, I wanna be Will. Yeah, I wanna be with.
The notion that at some point during that day that the Ramones had actually lined up and had lunch at Poncho's, and now they wanna be well. Now let's do something else. As I said before, there was a great sense of humor to this punk movement. It was not to be taken seriously. You could find humor in almost all the bands. And there was, as the punk thing swept England, it also found itself sweeping the continent. This is a record from France by a guy who used to be in a little kind of art rock band called Hubble Bubble. And he redubbed himself under the name Plastic Bertrand. And he cut this piece of French doggerel that nobody really has been able to come up exactly what the lyrics mean, but it's just a fun little wiggle. And he put it out it came out on Vogue Records in France, which was a label that had a little bit of muscle behind it. It ended up going to number one in almost every country in Europe, swept England, and it was never hit in the US, although it has wound up in some television commercials, and it was a big hit in South America as well. There was just something about this squirrely little record. Incredibly silly record, Ça Plan Pour Moi, from Plastic Bertrand, international hit fantastique. Let's go over to America. We had our own little odd thing happening with this record, which came out of New York, which has finally reared its head again as having something creative. Well, some people, sticklers, might say this came out of Rhode Island School of Design, and I'll accede to that, but New York, basically, the Talking Heads. Okay, so that we're up to late 77, and we're starting to see the influences, the secondary stuff coming out. We talked about electronic music briefly, and we saw how Kraftwerk had brought it into a melodic form. This is a guy named Daniel Miller. He would end up starting a little label called Mute Records, which would become a very important home for a lot of other electronic bands as we got into the 80s, most notably a little group called Depeche Mode. This was his first experiment, and it was a really odd little pop record with synthesizers that was, in 1977, really different and compelling.
Warm. Leatherette. Warm. Leatherette. Warm. Leatherette. Warm. Leatherette.
You could work out the lyrics to this thing pretty quick. There wasn't much of a challenge to it, but it was an interesting little record. Now, dig this. This is to show how the influence starts creeping around America, especially on college campuses. That seems to be where it was taking root. It was people like me who had access to a little radio station and somehow access to these records. I was buying a lot of them through mail order because you couldn't find them in the stores. And down in Athens, Georgia, there was a group of college students that decided, you know, I bet we could put together one of these new bands. But they weren't going to be punks because they were a little more artsy than that. That's the direction they were coming at it from. And they put this thing together, called themselves the B-52s.
We were at a party. The dear love fell in the day. Someone reached in.
back at the ranch, let's go back to England. The scene had pretty much centered around, in England, London. But there were things happening in the provinces. There was a scene happening up in Liverpool, centered around a little club called Eric's. And there was also a scene happening in Manchester. There's a great movie out there called 24-Hour Party People that kind of chronicles, in a very funny way, how the Manchester scene unfolded in the late 70s. And one of the band at its core of making that thing happen was the Sex Pistols. The Manchester was one of the few dates on that national tour, which got canceled. That was one of the few dates that remained, and they got booked into the Free Trade Hall there by members of a little band that hadn't really performed yet called the Buzzcocks. So here's a band that has heard about the Sex Pistols, couldn't get down to London to see them. Well, let's book them ourselves, and we'll be able to see them at their own gig. Well, they go to this gig up in Manchester. There's not many people there. There's maybe 30 or 40 people there, but almost everybody in the audience that was there at that show would go on to start their own group. And it was the birth of the Manchester underground scene, whether it was Mick Hucknall from Simply Red or the group we're about to hear, which become members of Joy Division, which would end up being mutated into New Order, or even John the Singing Postman. You know, they all come out of that gig at Manchester Free Trade Hall. And this is where Joy Division first found their foot. And Joy Division, instead of taking punk to its the angry end and the frenetic end, they went the other way and got really dark and brooding, still with that indie knack to them. And they were kind of in 78, kind of got that notion of, oh, this is the thinking man's punk band. This is, you know, if you're going to read a lot of, you know, dark philosophical works, this is the band that you're going to listen to. Obviously not that. Joy Division would end up slowly building a base in Manchester, becoming one of those critics' favorites in England. They didn't tour much. They didn't play that many concerts. And they would only really find fame afterwards when, on May 18th of 1980, their lead singer, on the eve of going to America and trying to, you know, finally break out of England, got depressed and hung himself. Thus spelling the end of Joy Division, but creating New Order in its wake. And New Order didn't linger long in this mode, this dark mode. They quickly mutated into kind of an alternative disco band, which some thought was a complete aberration, like yours truly, and others thought was the true meaning in life of Joy Division and that crowd. So we were very split on that at the moment. Let me show you another way, very graphically in music, how somebody was changed by what was happening on the scene. I'm going to play the song as released in October of 1978, and then we're going to go back and hear an earlier version before this artist was so inspired.
Broke 'cause it's
Okay, so that is Radio Radio. It's basically Elvis Costello thumbing his nose at the established radio, which wouldn't play his records. Now, he had been in the music scene for quite some time, since 1972, when he had a little folk band up in Liverpool named Rusty. And then he put together Flip City, which was a pub rock band. It was just playing your typical like mid-70s sound like everybody else. Then in 1976, he starts doing these sort of snatty little pop songs. And he had released several records up to this point, but they were selling well in the underground, but he could not get the radio to play his records despite good sales. And so he took his song Radio Radio and just kind of like, you know, faced down the beast and said, you know, they're playing, you know, the radio's in the hands of such a bunch of people who want to anesthetize the way that we feel. It's interesting that we can hear this same song 2 years or 3 years earlier, before he got caught up in the whole punk ethos. And let me play it for you. Let me make sure I've got the right track. 54. Yes. Okay. Same song, same artist, 3 years earlier, and it's actually a love song to radio. He's not burned out on it yet. We've got a difference in tempo, we've got a difference in style, but most importantly, he has chosen to bite the hand that feeds on the later version of the song, which just, you know, wasn't done. That is how you were going to spell an end to your career on radio, is if you actually attacked the beast head on. It actually turned the trick for him. And other artists would do that. Graham Parker, most notably, one of his friends from the pub rock scene. Let me hit you with one more. This is another one of those little aberrant things that happened in the U.S. The thing that we had going for us here in the U.S. that they didn't have going in England was that we were the home of Elvis Presley, and we were also the home of rockabilly music. Now, when the punk thing started happening, there were those who were into that sort of rebellious country music who thought, well, maybe we can take punk and meld it with rockabilly and create something new. Most notably, one of the most famous bands to do that was a group called the Stray Cats, who came from up in Long Island. They could not get bookings in the Long Island area in 76, 77. Well, they started off as the Bloodless Pharaohs, which might have been a bit of a stretch for a name. But they couldn't get any bookings. And when they finally got enough money together, they went to England and actually started getting signed and making records and came back to America as conquering heroes. There's this other band that I want to play for you that was hanging around the South, and they didn't really care about getting a record deal. They were making their own records. They were using that true punk ethos of do it yourself, do it cheap, and put it out, and who cares if anybody buys it? We think it's cool. They recorded some of their records were actually recorded, and they actually enjoyed performing at institutions for the insane, because they said they got a better reaction out of the crowd there. And this is a great example of what they were like. This is taking punk and melding it with rockabilly and coming out with something that we had never heard before. This is from December of 1978, it's the Cramps.
Nine to six eyes, I gotta go this right.
I love that line. I've got 96 tears and 96 eyes, a nod to the garage band question mark of the Mysterians. Okay, so there's another one of the little odd things that's going on. And the train keeps moving forward, and it seems every couple months it splits off in another direction. What was once a reasonably focused movement in 75, 76, we are only two or three years into it, and it has already gone off in all these different offshoots. We actually get a real breakthrough when how would you describe that? This is like tart candy. It's absolute, you know, it's the Archie's sugar. It's that sort of tripe, but it's so good at it. It became another worldwide hit and redefined that pop music could exist with purely electronic instruments. You do not need guitar, bass, drums. You can do it purely electronically. So where Kraftwerk had tried to do it in their very Germanic way, looking very serious, and then we had seen Daniel Miller with the Normal do it, very stripped down, but very bizarre, this guy actually takes it and makes it incredibly commercial and breaks down another barrier. Really will rot your teeth if you listen to too much of it. We'll explore another one of those little sidelines. We talked about Bob Marley, how Bob Marley had this influence on a lot of the punks, and there was a scene that existed in England in the early 60s that was seeing a revival for the first time in 1979. And that was there was this thing called ska music. I don't know if you know what ska is. Ska is the Jamaican music that was the immediate precursor to reggae and came right after calypso. It was around 1961, 62, right in that groove. It was dance music that owed a great debt to music from New Orleans, like Fats Domino and what have you, but shoved through a calypso filter, so you came up with this kind of new modern calypso music that was very danceable, and it was called ska. Quite popular in Jamaica in the early 60s. There was a large community of West Indians in London, so they brought this when they emigrated to England. They brought this music with them. Okay, so this is burbling on in the underscene. When reggae becomes popular in England in the early 70s, a lot of the bands that are looking for something to do start gravitating towards that West Indian music, but they don't want to do reggae music because, well, reggae music is everywhere. Let's do something really different. Ooh, let's do ska music, because ska music, nobody was really doing it anymore. So this especially happened up in Birmingham, which is quite close to Liverpool up in the north of England, a rather poor part of the country. We had this scene where about three or four bands that were all down the same road got together and would play gigs, and they finally started putting some records out, and they had some really remarkably fun recordings like this. So that is a great example of the ska sound. It was kind of all started by an indie label called Two Tone Records, which had a black and white checkerboard motif. And soon the black and white checkerboard motif there was a little guy that they had on their label, a little stick figure drawing, a guy, I'm trying to think what his name was, Jabbo Smith, I think it was the character's name. And that became as famous as the music. It was spread around England so much that you would see all these kids who would crop their head incredibly short, like that long, and they would wear suits and white shirts and skinny ties and listen to ska music. And it led to, most notably, a band called Madness, which came out of this. That was a group called The Specials. And then there was another group called The Selector. But there were a bunch of others as well, most of them coming right out of Birmingham. Just a little ways away in Liverpool, from a club that was across the street from the Cavern Club, which bore fruit under the name The Beatles, there was another scene brewing. And they were kind of taking another different side road. Instead of doing the punk thing, they started several of the bands, and there were these three guys who had a band called the Crucial Three. Never recorded, but the Crucial Three split off into three different bands, and they were all infatuated with American garage bands of the 60s, and they started trying to recreate that sound of 1966, 1967, that kind of psychedelic thing. This is one of the examples. This is a group called Echo and the Bunnymen, and their first record from May of 79. This was kind of the new young sound of Liverpool, were bands doing that sort of thing. Now let's go back down to London, and there's another thing that starts up in 1979, and I'm sure you've seen fruit of this movement, and it took a while to get the name, but they became called the Goth Movement, the Gothic Movement, and the people who were involved in this, they still wear the uniform today. They dressed in black, heavy eye makeup, white pasty complexion, dye your hair black, and act really gloomy. And one of the first bands to really do that was a group called Bauhaus. And Peter Murphy was at the fore of Bauhaus, and he was a stick insect of a man that could really pull off the whole I'm the son of the dark side and I howl at the moon sort of thing. The group, here again, did not sell that many records, but would become hugely influential and changed the course of many other people.
The goose is dead, the bats have left the bell tower, the victims have been bled, red velvet lines, the black box. The goose is dead.
It's a 12-inch single, and they do spend 5 minutes of the song going undead, 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 and it's all very echoey and everything. A pretty astounding record in its day. It was very, very, very different, and that's what we were looking for. We were looking for something that was moving it forward, because God knows the mainstream music was not moving forward at all. But here, in a span of just a few years, all this innovation is happening. It was an incredible time to be involved in music. Let's go over to Ireland. There were, at that point, the most famous band to come out of Ireland was Thin Lizzy. And that was about it. And then in 77, a little upstart punk band called the Boomtown Rats started knocking around Dublin, and they would end up with actually having a few British hit records in 78. This inspired many other do-it-yourself bands who didn't dream that they could do what Thin Lizzy was doing, but we could do what the Boomtown Rats were doing. And one of those groups was this one. Let's see if I can play the right track. Yes, you're all ahead of me, and you know who I'm going to play. That's a very young U2 at the point where they have just released their first record. And strangely enough, they managed to impress a lot of people at their live gigs that this is a band worth noting. And if you had happened to see U2 back in that time, you would have noticed that they had head and shoulders above everybody else. Even if their musicianship wasn't there, they were extraordinarily charismatic on stage. You just really wanted to, you know, go to their concerts because they were such enormous fun. They got a deal with CBS Records in England, and then backed up, the deal got kind of whittled away at the last minute, and they said, okay, you can release the record but on CBS, but only in Ireland. Well, it was like telling them you could sell it, but just to 12 of your good friends. You know, it just wasn't going to encourage them at all. And so they said, fine, that's okay with us. And they took those recordings that they believed in, put it out on their own, and spun them down to London, where they struck a deal and would wind up with Island Records, where they are today. Island had the foresight to see that CBS had indeed missed out on a good thing. This is an apocryphal story, very similar to Decca Records taking a pass on the Beatles in 1962 because they didn't feel that guitar groups were going to last. But U2 have endured. They have, at that point, they were actually a little busier band than they have become. They have again fallen into their groove and are very comfortable with it. On these demo sessions from 1978, it's incredible because you can hear them trying to be about six different bands and trying to discover what they're going to do in the edge. Their guitar player is frantically playing as fast as he can because that's what you're supposed to do. He's not learned to lay back and play very simply and beautifully yet. Let's see if I've got anything else that's really odd here. Okay, I'll spin you one more. This is a record. We're going up to 1980. This is a record that caused enormous trouble in England, and it seems so silly now. There was Adam and the Ants, and Adam and the Ants were a band that had existed in 76, 77. They'd actually existed before the Sex Pistols and then kind of become a band that was very much into fetish wear and kind of sadomasochistic stuff once they saw the Sex Pistols. And then you come forward a few years and they rediscover the music of the Burundi drummers and work it into their sound and become ant music, this kind of junka 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 drum sound that made them famous. After they had gotten to that point and had their first hit record, their manager, Malcolm McLaren, decided to do the thing that managers do from time to time, and that is to take the lead singer of the band and fire him because obviously he costs them too much and he won't listen to his Svengali-like control. So Adam goes off and starts another Adam and the Ants, and the existing Ants that remained became a new group called Bow Wow Wow. Malcolm McLaren hooked them up with a new singer because Adam, he didn't think, was capable enough, and they hooked him up with a 15-year-old half-Burmese, half-English girl who was attractive enough, but she really couldn't sing that well. And they cut their first record called C30, C60, C90 Go. Here again, EMI Records put this record out. They didn't listen to it. They didn't really know what it was about. And it was a song which advocated taping, home taping of music. At this very moment in history, there were campaigns all across England with a cassette and crossbones below it saying, home taping is killing music. This was an enormous campaign trying to save the record industry, which is a familiar song. And here EMI, one of the largest companies in England, puts out a record that advocates the very thing that the industry is trying to stop. It caused a lot of trouble. My then girlfriend brought that record back for me on a trip to England. It was released when she was in London in July of 1980. And I remember the first time I heard that record, I was astounded because it was the familiar Adam and the Ants beat, but this new thing, which kind of is a precursor to what we would know as perhaps rap music. Could this be the start of another trend in 1980 that wouldn't find full flower for another 10 years? Perhaps. an incredible record, here again, by a group that had their moment in the sun, and then beyond this, they had a couple other hits and then kind of drifted off, but they had planted that seed, and they had managed to thumb their nose at the very industry that was supporting them, EMI Records, which deleted that as quickly as they could. It was a very funny record, though. Okay, Tom, I'm going to give up and
we're
going to
take some questions, but I'm going to come down there and give you the microphone.
Or you can shout it out.
He never... No, I have to hit for the recording. That is one rule.
Okay.
We can't break. He never said this, but I'll say it. He introduced a lot of these groups to the American audience, forever changing the music scene of America.
Aww. Okay, now Tom's going to pass a mic among you for the recording. So this will be for the record. Any questions? I'm ready. It's trivia from hell time.
Oh, you got okay.
Oh, April's got one.
First of all, thank you very much for your presentation tonight. It was wonderful.
Oh, thanks. It was entirely off the cuff. I wasn't really prepared.
Fantastic. But I'm wondering, though, are there any bands today that are kind of carrying on the torch and the spirit of what went on back then?
Well, in some regards, you could say the Hives and the Vines. I am a little out of touch with what's happening right now because when I was shown the door at the Edge in 1994, and had the cold, hard reality of, after 20 years of getting all the free records I could eat, having to buy them, and plus being out of work, I kind of got behind the curve when it comes to keeping up with new stuff. Friends of mine in the business do slip me stuff from time to time they think I will enjoy, most notably Jeff Kay. And the Hives and the Vines are two bands that I found really strike a chord with me, although I gotta tell you, on some level, I wish they'd find their own music, because we've kind of been there and done that. Invent your own stuff. So I kind of have mixed feelings about it, but yeah, I do enjoy the records. Okay. It's kind of, you know, some of these bands that are out there doing the new wave stuff, it's kind of like Sha-na-na to me. It's kind of, you know, they're in a costume and they're kind of doing music of another era in kind of a modern way, but they're still Sha-na-na. I like it, but I feel guilty about it. So. I'm sorry.
Great presentation. Really enjoyed
it.
What type of system do you have at home? What do you play your music on at home? I'm just curious.
A dual, like a mid-80s dual turntable with multiple head cartridges to accommodate 78s when I need to go to that speed. And just a real standard off-the-rack, you know, kind of Kenwood amplifier and a couple really nice speakers. It's a pretty basic system. I'm not one of those... You know, got to have the best system in the world. But I do get picky about my turntable and that it needs to reproduce a record as it was recorded, as it was intended. And I never really had the clarity of how well 78s are recorded until I got that turntable several years ago. Some 78s from the 1940s and 50s are astounding recordings when they're played on the right instrument and they're clean platters. So, but I'm not one of these that disparages CDs because they don't sound like records. I like CDs. They're convenient.
How much time did you actually spend at, you probably spent a lot of time at clubs listening to these bands live. Did you spend a lot of time there to the point where you've had any like hearing damage, long-term hearing loss?
No. I was always pretty careful about that. But between 1979 and 94, I was out pretty much four nights a week. Three and four nights a week. And that's another reason why I'm not real keen on going to clubs anymore, because I've kind of done that. And my patience is really worn thin. I hate to admit it, but you know, if I see a band, it's kind of after 20 minutes, it's kind of like, you know, I've kind of had it. I've seen these guys. I want to see the next thing, which probably is what led to me developing the radio sash sort of tension span system protocol that I've been working on lately. I got to see in my time in those glorious years of the late 70s and early 80s and even up into the 90s, I got to see an astounding number of bands at their infancy, at the very beginning. And you can get really spoiled to that. I have no interest at all seeing somebody on a Diamond Vision screen in a large setting, because when you've, you know, I saw U2 twice in a club that held less than 100 people. I saw Sarah McLachlan at a reception in Seattle where she was playing to five people and nobody knew who she was. She was just being introduced that weekend as the new signing from Network Records. And a friend of mine and I sat about 6 feet away from her on chairs, just like that, you know, just kind of, this gal's just astounding. The Sex Pistols concert here in Dallas, you know, a watershed moment on that American tour. It was the best concert they played by far musically, and the performance was an incredible performance. There was maybe four or 500 people at that show, and 250 of those people wanted to kick our ass. And there's just so many other shows. We had a little club called the Hot Club here in Dallas that was on Maple at Hondo down in Little Mexico. And it was a cedar or a cinder block building that couldn't have held more than 300 people. And in the course of about 3 years, we had everybody from the Stray Cats and the Stranglers and Ultravox and you know, everybody who was on the scene at that time. They would always come to Texas. They would play New York because they would always get a gig in New York. They would sometimes swing down to Atlanta, and on the way to Los Angeles, where their next gig was, they always stopped in Texas. In Dallas, because we were getting a ton of airplay on that crazy Saturday night radio show that I was doing on a major market station with a big antenna. And so we were breaking records here, and the bands paid us back by coming here. We saw REM twice before they had a record deal. When they were an unsigned act, they played Dallas twice. And we even had them up in the studio talking are you going to have a big career in music? And they're, well, we don't know if we're going to go into music or we're going to finish up our degrees. You know, they were still at that point in their career. It's fun seeing bands at that point because you really can connect with them and form bonds that you can exploit for years later, that you can, you know, watch them grow and give them the support, and they can count on you to, you know, if they've got a new record, you'll always give them a break, because there's a lot of people that treat music as very disposable these days. And when I was at the Edge, it was great. When we put that station on, that there were a lot of bands, and they would say, oh, I hear George is behind this station. Let's make sure we go there. And so whenever we needed somebody, we were going to throw a festival or something, and I needed some bands, it was very easy to book bands because they were ready to repay the favor. So that was fun.
I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
Where does Gibby Haynes fit in all this? Although I can't tell the name of his band here in the library. And secondly,
briefly, Gibby and I know each other from high school. He was the class before me. We both were graduates of Lake Highlands High School. I actually knew his father better than I knew Gibby, Mr. Peppermint. And his band, we barely played at all on the Edge. And after he was extraordinarily abusive to me at Lollapalooza, I pulled his records and didn't play him again because I could. This is a guy I barely knew in high school. He was a total basketball nerd, and I was a band weenie. And when I met him at Lollapalooza, we were ready to do an interview, and he didn't know that I was going to tape. He thought I was live. And he was very nice until the interview started, and then he launched into a string of obscenity and personal remarks to disparage me. And I asked him very calmly, I said, you know, there are 52 radio stations in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, your hometown. 51 of them have elected to never play one of your records. Would you like to make it a clean sweep, Gibby? And he laid into me again, and I said, you're 52 for 52. And then to his horror, I asked the guy, I was still on the microphone, and I said, hey, Ernie, you can stop rolling tape? And Gibby could hear it in my headphones because I pulled it out. I got it, George, you want me to put the tape in your office? I said, yeah, you go ahead and put the tape in my office and pull the Surfer's record from rotation and toss it under my door. He doesn't need to be played anymore. And Gibby was just kind of like, oh, geez, the guy's serious. And I said, yes, I am. So Gibby and I have had a rocky relationship.
What's the best band ever came out of the Dallas-Fort Worth area?
Oh, God, there's so many. There's so many really good bands to come out of here. Should I say Blind Lemon Jefferson and be really cool?
Yeah, be really cool.
I don't know. This is an argument. I'm on the board of directors at the Texas Musicians Museum, which right now is in Hillsboro, but is probably going to move to a major city near you very soon. We have this argument come up all the time that people get into Austin pride and that Austin is the home of all things holy musically in Texas. And I had this little game that I would play with people and would say, okay, I'll tell you what, for every band you can tell me that is worthwhile or famous from Austin, I will name five from the Dallas-Fort Worth area and we'll see who runs out first. And they always end up, you know, dying a death because they can't get past. Usually they'll start with Stevie Ray Vaughan, which is great fun because Stevie Ray Vaughan's from Oak Cliff, of course. And then they'll go with something like Joe Ely, which he's from Lubbock, so that doesn't count. Well, what about Janis Joplin? Sorry, that's Port Arthur, you know. And they run out of musicians pretty quick. We've had so many great musicians. I hate to single out, you know, any.
Say five of them.
Say five of them. And are we going to put constraints in this box into time?
Not at all.
Oh, geez. You see, one of my favorite local bands was a group called Pop Poppins that never amounted to much of nothing. The New Bohemians were really clever for what they did. They were a little too smart for me. I really hate to kind of like narrow it down because I have so many favorites that are out of here. I really like Delbert McClinton's really early stuff. You know, I think his stuff is pretty doggone special, but that's like his early 60s stuff. There's a couple garage bands, you know, that like Nobody's Children that nobody's ever heard of. That is one of the best records of the 1960s to me, but I don't think it sold more than 50 copies. But a friend of mine produced it, and so I got a freebie, and it's a fantastic record. I mean, they sing about going out for entertainment and parking behind the Twin, and lights the stove. It's leaking, a rusty stove leaking gas everywhere. I light a match, it blasts my face and burns off my hair. Good times. You know, fabulous, fabulous lyrics. But just way over the top for 1966. So I don't know. I have too much music in my life to make decisions like that, Tom. I'm sorry to say.
Thank you, George. It's been a wonderful evening.
There you go. Thank you. Oh, and I wanted to add, if you are into this sort of stuff, yes, I would hype my own book. I don't have extra copies of it here because it's on Amazon and it's like $25. It's cheap. And it comes with a CD. Of interviews and music and what have you. But if you're way into the music, I could recommend 45 Revolutions. It's a sizable investment. It's about $100. It is some anal retentive in England put this together. And between 1976 and 79, it catalogs every single independent punk, new wave, what have you record in England in that time period. And it is just thick with them. It's incredibly accurate. They built quite a bit of their research off my book and then went 12 steps further. It's an astounding tome, but it is the sort of thing you should ask somebody else to buy you for Christmas because it's too expensive.
George will be available for questions afterwards.
Oh, of course.
Have a good time.